Time for the message. I believe one of the responsibilities, sometimes an unwelcome responsibility, of the preacher or the prophet is to sound the warning from the wall and tell what he sees. And tonight I've come to a sin that if I'm any prophet is going to be soft pedal from here on. There was a time when the preachers, all of them that were fundamental, cried out against liquor and drinking. I'm talking about dram drinkers, social drinkers, and they said, like Billy Sunday, anybody that drinks or sells or serves or makes or rents a building to the liquor crowd is pulling on the same rope with the devil. Now, that's the way the preachers used to preach. Now then, practically all the grocery stores are selling liquor, and it's not groceries. It is not a food. It's a poison. Therefore, there's been a tapering off. Now, stay with me. There was a time when every fundamental, evangelistic, Christ-centered, Bible-loving, hell-hating preacher would really skin Hollywood. Boy, listen, they'd preach on subjects like hell over Hollywood. Reckon what happened to that bunch. I don't believe you can really preach against Hollywood and operate one of their gadgets.
That's right. Amen.
Now, this is the one thing right here that divides almost the sheep from the goats.
Yeah.
Because it's the most popular, I'm talking about television.
Yeah.
It's the most popular gadget. It's the most immoral. It's the dirtiest brainwashing outfit. It's ruined the families of America. And yet, the preachers are preaching control. Be sure and be careful. Now, what you let your children watch, and only being careful, just get rid of it. Folks, what's happened to the stand? The first thing the Lord did to me, when I got called to preach, he told me to come out of the picture show.
Yeah.
Come out of the picture show. He said, never go back to the picture show. And so the Lord gave me that kind of conviction. He's blessed it. And I've sought to be true to it. All right? We'll go a little further. There was a time when the preachers would preach on the unnatural, unscriptural hairdos of boys and men. But they about tapered off on it. And I noticed some of the fundamental brethren are getting their hair done instead of cut. Had some things. And look what happened to the preachers. A few years ago, that was crying out against the thing he said that it's against nature for a man to have long hair. I read where two men lost their scalp because their hair got in the machine. I mean, it scalped them. Doctor was busy gluing it back on. These two men said, I'll guarantee you we'll never have long hair again. Folks, if we just go on what the Bible says, I'm coming up to something in a minute, and it's going to be hard for you to believe, but you watch and see, because of the popularity, the acceptance, and the more a sin is accepted, the more the modernists will never preach against it. They'll agree and say, well, I guess it's here to stay, you know. Well, the devil may be here to stay at least for a while, but I'm going to give him a rough time. Old Dr. Tidwell used to say, the Wicked flee when no man pursues. Better he'll make better times he get after him. All right. Well, now then, I'm ready to introduce, and first of all, I'm going to accept the accusation that I'm not going to have compassion. I'm going to be unkind. And I'm going to be a Pharisee. And because I'm going to cry out against the civil rights of what they call a minority group. But I feel like that with this mighty end time sin increasing, we better warn these boys and these girls and these ladies and all of our people. Knowing there'll be two characteristics of the end time generation just before Jesus comes. It'll be like Noah's day, when violence covers the face of the earth, and the marriage vow is ignored, and wickedness, and it'll be like Sodom's day, Lot's day, just before Jesus comes again. Now, folks, if we see these things coming to pass, we might as well look up, because our redemption is going near. Now, tonight, I'm preaching on the subject meaner than a murderer, and that's a homosexual. They're the most dangerous people alive today. And I've got every reason to say it, and I can prove it with the Word of God, because they become reprobates, which means they don't have charge of their mind. Therefore, they're guilty of the mass murders. They're guilty of the horrible, bloody sex crimes. And they are the people that molest little boys and little girls. Now, therefore, I just say right before you leave me, they're meaner than murderers because of what they do. Somebody sent me this clipping right here. This is in the Lone Star State of Texas. Home for homosexual runaways closes. Scott Helber, 52. Melvin Mitchell, 40. One of them 40, one of them 52. Who for years have operated G-U-Y-S. That's guys. That means gay, unwanted youth service. Did you get it? They call it youth service. Those men up in middle age, they're trapping little boys. And it goes ahead to say, and they admitted, he just admitted right here, that they engaged in sex with boys younger than 17. What's my subject tonight? Meaner than a murderer. Now, before you accuse me of having no compassion, no love, being mean, and condemning, we probably take more homosexuals than any other organization in America, and do more with them and for them than anybody else. And I will not subscribe to the psychiatrist's conclusion that once a sodomite, and boys, that's what the Bible calls them, and we'll refer to them tonight as sodomites. You'll never get people to give up sin until they see it sin. And it's a double sin of lesbianism, women with women, or women with girls, and men with men, and men with boys. And I'm going to give you what the Bible says about it in the message tonight. But I'm going to give you 15 things that I see that's wrong with sodomites. Now, before I get any further, and people are listening on the radio, and some of you may be getting ready to turn it off, let me give you something. Jesus and the shed blood of Him on the cross is the only remedy there is. And you can be forgiven if you have not crossed the deadline and become a reprobate, and with a reprobate mind.
That's right.
Now, That's the reason preachers need to preach on this. We need to preach to little boys and girls on this. Before they get molested and get deep and their little minds are twisted. And then God gives them up. I believe one of the reasons we've got so much suicide among teenagers is little children are developing reprobate minds at an early age. You know why? They watch television, pornography, they're on dope, and then they become homosexuals. Their minds are shot. I believe the mind of a child is a very tender, delicate matter. It has to be a child's mind. It's not a grown mind. It's not a mature mind. A little girl's mind at the age of 11 and 10, and a little girl, 9, gave birth to a baby the other day. 10 and 11 and 12. Those little minds are just immature. And when you put adult facts and sins into juvenile minds, you're going to ruin those little minds. Now, strange as it may seem, we've been accused by the Court of Times, sewer line, that we ruin the minds of our girls and boys by giving them, quote, the Bible for breakfast, dinner, and supper. Amen. And one of the misleading men of this city said, why, that's enough to ruin their little minds. Now, what he didn't know is, and I'd tell him if I could see him, his big mind is already ruined. His mind is depraved. All right, turn in your Bible, please, to Genesis chapter 19. We'll start out with that horrible picture. And may I ask a question? Does God ever change his mind? Would God think the same today that he thought back in the Genesis days? Would he say, well, people are different now. Human nature is different. No. Chapter 19. Two angels came to Sodom at even, and Lot sat in the gate of Sodom. And Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face toward the ground. Maybe there's one thing good that I've not seen before about Lot. He still recognized people from heaven. Even though he seems to be in a backslidden condition, forgot what his Abraham taught him. And he said, behold now, my lords, turn in, I pray you, into your servant's house. Tarry all night, wash your feet, and ye shall rise up early and go on your ways. Something else I saw. Ordinarily, the host would wash the feet of the visitors. Maybe Lot realized that his hands were not fit to wash heaven's feet. Maybe Lot was cold and calloused and said, wash your feet yourself. Oh, some things we got to see in this tonight. And ye shall rise up, what? Early. And go. They came at even. They came at twilight. They came late in the day. And Lot is saying, go in the house there, wash your feet, and get up early and pull out. Reckon why? Man looks to me like he'd say, stay at least a week. Well, I'm telling you, it's a joy to have you. I've never had such a blessing. All of my children, I want them to meet you. Huh? No. Folks, you remember when Lot started on the down trail, when he pitched his tents toward Sodom, and he saw what? Grass. Is that what this generation sees? Is this a generation of Sodomites? And so now he's wound up in Sodom. They said, nay, but We will abide in the street all night. Another conclusion, it looked like Lot's not going to be able to host them for the night. They said, no, we'll just stay in the street. They didn't do Abraham like that. They went in and drank buttermilk. And ate homemade butter. I mean, they really had a big time up there. I mean, he didn't have to argue with them. He didn't say, I wish y'all to stay with me. Won't you come in? And of course, you remember what they said? They said, where is Sarah, thy wife? And Abraham, I think, is a little bit surprised. He said, why, she's there in the tent where she ought to be. She's not down at the bridge club. She's not down at the political rally. She's back there. And so she prepared a meal. Now, here they are down in Sodom. And remember this. They're in Sodom because Abraham prayed. And folks, you boys, you're over there now. And God sent his angel to get you to Corpus Christi because your mother prayed and your daddy prayed and your preacher prayed and your friends prayed. And you're here tonight. And you girls are here, though you didn't want to come. To hear, though you didn't want to come. You're here tonight because somebody prayed for you. And so here the angels are down there to rescue Lot. Now, remember, Sodom is a Sodomite city. It has one particular characteristic. It was saturated with homosexuals. I mean, you know that's so. One of the reasons you know it, and they can talk about being Christians and having their homosexual churches and their pastors, and I heard a debate today on a tape that they sent me of a woman preacher that said, I am a practicing lesbian, and I'm a Christian, and I intend to be in heaven with you, preacher. I mean, she was bold, and she said, you're unkind. You don't have compassion, and said, you ignore our civil rights. We consider those sinful wrongs. That's what the Bible says about it. Folks, do not listen to the interpretation of two people. Never. One of them, the man who runs the liquor store, and the person who is a homosexual. Don't listen, because their minds are not in shape to interpret the Word of God. I tell you something else that happened. These angels, of course, they were finally persuaded, and they went in to visit Lot. And then, a little later on, brother, you talk about a demonstration and a parade of the Sodomites. They came, knocked on the door, and said, Lot, you got company, got some men. We want to see the men. Now, folks, this is in the Bible. And we might as well face it. Whether you think it's nice or not, we're facing a repeat of Sodom's day. Lot came to the door and said, I've got company from heaven. They said, that's right, we want them. Bring them out that we may know them. And if you don't know what they were up to, they were sex deviants or sex demons. They knew what, and Lot knew exactly what that bunch of Sodomites wanted. He wasn't in the dark. He didn't say, well, y'all, are y'all going to take them out and visit with them and let them tell you about heaven? No! We want to know them. And here's another thing, and it's just like that today. They were men and little boys. They were right there. Men and boys came out that night. So far as we know, the ladies, the girls were not present. It was the big homosexuals and the little homosexuals. And there they were. They're coming. I think it was the men and their little boy prostitutes that came with them. And there they are. And they said, and Lot said, listen, you can't do this. I mean, I've the angels are here. And they said, I've got two daughters. Now, folks, far as I'm concerned, here's a picture of a compromising, double-living sort of a Lot. I've got two little girls. Now, you imagine this. And I'll bring them out, and they've never had a date, and you can do with them anything you want to do. Brother, Daddy ought to say to that bunch of sodomites, over my dead body. Why, listen, by the time, and I'm going to say this openly, and I know what you're accusing me of, a bunch of you modernists and folks outside, you know, that listen, and especially that other crowd, the sodomite crowd. By the time those men had stated their request, Lot ought to have his gun loaded. Yes. Oh, I know that stirs up the people's unkindness toward us. But, brother, do you believe that a bunch of sodomites has a right to come and invade a man's home? Now, what about privacy? Do we have anything private left in this country anymore? We've been invaded right here by the DHR. This doesn't belong to the state. This belongs to God. God's people gave this. They came in here just like a bunch of communists and said, shut her down. Where are the little girls going? That's not our concern. I remember me, I asked Mr. Johnson one question. What do you think about the facilities? That's not a part of my report. In other words, I could care less. I want these girls and boys out of here and close her down and shut her down and be done with it. And that's it. All right, I'm going to give you something else. Of course, you know what happened, don't you? The angel said, part of our business is to protect even backsliders. Well, I'm glad, aren't you? You think of the days that you lived like the devil and compromised and slipped around in the bushes and walked through the weeds and act like the devil, and yet angels flittering over you and fluttering over you every day saying, I'm watching you. I'm going to keep you from getting you girls over in the Help Hurst home. That's right, little old Nora. Bless your heart. Wasn't the Lord good to you when you was out there and brought you back? See, he was still with you. You know why? Because there was a time when you really trusted Jesus. And you lived like, you remember the time you used to go visiting with me? And we had a good time, didn't we? And then the devil said, I think they're getting over. And he did. I mean, lock, stock, and barrel. He got her. I mean, she turned against everything that was right and good. And yet, the guardian angel said, oh, no, you're not going to get Nora. I'll get her back. And folks, how good he's been to you and to me. In all these years when we... Now, what happened? The angels reached out. And they did. And to me, this is a picture of sodomites. They blinded every one of them. I believe that every sodomite... For instance, I read... I heard in the debate today. They said, we are just as moral as you are. And we have just as finer love as you have, talking to this preacher that was in the debate. And then this is what they say, and this is why we're unkind. God made us like this. We are God made homosexuals just like you are God made heterosexuals, and you have no right to criticize. You're not criticizing us. You're criticizing God who made us. What am I talking about? Reprobate mind. That woman is as bold as a lion. And then, you know what she mentioned? Boy, this is horrible. I just put it down. She said, do you realize that the Methodists and the Presbyterians and the Catholics and the Episcopalians and the Lutherans and the Disciples of Christ and the Church of Christ have all endorsed our way of life? And the day's going to come when all the old line denominations are going to line up with them. You wait and see. You, just a few. Fact is, there's a lot of preachers that will never cry out against it now in the big highfalutin churches because they know this thing is on the increase, and they just say it's not very majestic or nice for us to cry out and call these sins by name. Folks, you wait and see. I told you the other day, and it came out in the paper, that the old line denominations, in other words, the older you are as a denomination, the more worldly you get, because God never did start a denomination.
Right.
You may start out, I can remember, and I say it on the radio, it doesn't bother me anymore, because I'm too close to heaven to worry about it.
Amen.
I can remember the time when our denomination was in knee breeches. I'm talking about Baptist General Convention of Texas, 48 years ago, when the missionary, the Association of Missionaries came out. You know what he said? Brethren, I want you all to know, we're just your humble servant. Whatever we can do for you, we would never interfere with the program of the local church. We have no suggestions to make. We are just servants of the church. The denomination was born only to serve the local church. And 48 years later, the denomination rules the church. That's where the government starts out, isn't it? The government says, now we're the government of the people, by the people, and for the people, and we want you all to know that we're just your old uncle, and we're going to take care of it. We'll do whatever you tell us to do. And the old uncle become the big papa. And they own everything. And they keep a grabbing. Oh, listen, of the bureaucrats, by the bureaucrats, and for the bureaucrats. And there it is. All right, let me give you something else. If sodomy is such a fine thing, I ask you two questions. How come there wasn't more righteous people down there? Are the Sodomites soul winners? They couldn't even find ten.
Right.
Am I right?
Right?
I mean, you remember Abraham started out with 50, and then I think Abraham knew Lot compromised.
Yeah.
See, Lot and his big family, they all the 150, but he pulled down to 45, 40, 30, 20, and he said, Lord, I hope you'll be patient with me. He said, I haven't been down there lately, and I just wonder if you can find 10. They've got to be 10. Now, let's see. There's Mr. and Mrs. Lot and all the little Lots and the Lot's children and the grandchildren. And the, man, they've got to be 10 down there. I taught Lot how to witness. You know he's got that many righteous down there. There wasn't that many righteous people. You know why? It's a city of Sodomites. And they're not soul winners. Sodomites don't win souls.
Right.
You know why? They don't have the power of God. And I do not believe that Sodomites can be saved. I mean that they are saved. Now, if they've not gotten a reprobate mind, Jesus will save them. If they'll call on God and repent and forsake and turn from their sin.
Right.
I don't believe God will save. I was down to jail one night preaching, and I made the statement, and I said, now, and one of the men raised the question. He said, Brother Wolf, will there be any murderers in heaven? I said, not one. Not a one. Well, he said, I guess that seals my doom because I'm a murderer. I said, now then, I've got good news for you.
Amen.
You may be a murderer now, my dear brother, but if you'll trust Jesus tonight and be saved, you can go to heaven just like I do because you won't be a murderer anymore. And he smiled and he said, "That's good, isn't it? Folks, you don't have to be a sodomite.